gonna see them. There they are. Come on up, and they're actually going to introduce themselves, so I'm gonna go ahead and sit down.
How's everyone doing today? Sorry, I'm just nervous. My name is Aaron Seaman Via. This is Will Lang on the guitar, and Becky Loomis on the drums. We are Walt Whitman students and are in the 9th grade. We are tonight to celebrate one of the world's most recognized musicians, Jimi Hendrix. Hendrix was known for his legendary guitar playing and impact on African-American music and just rock music in general. On top of playing the guitar left-handed, he is recognized as the creator of the modern electric guitar sound. We hope our instrumental cover of The Wind Cries Mary on his first album, Our Human Experience, can help show how his music influenced the world we live in today. Thank you and enjoy our performance.
Thank you.
I just want to make sure that I invite all of you to please come out tomorrow evening. Get there 6 o'clock, 6:15. We're gonna try and start on time as we have a packed agenda. So we definitely invite you all to come out. So just remember, this is a joint community event. We're working with the town of Huntington. We have our elementary schools. We have our Silas. We have Stinson. We have the high school. So it's definitely a great collaborative effort that is great to have all the community come together for a joyous occasion. So this is fantastic and a bunch of different ideas and some great celebration. So we will see you tomorrow night and enjoy the rest of the evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Officially the process of developing the budget for the 2024-2025 school year, and Dr. Delia will kick us off.
Yes, pitches and catches reported today, so I guess it's time for budget development. So we are moving along pretty quickly here in the school year. Simply it's the middle of February. Time doesn't slow down for anything or anyone. So in putting together, and I have to give credit to Mr. Conway and all the departments and all the building administration and teachers all play a role in putting together the budget for the school district. Yes, here, as we know, we hold about $210 million. So it is no small, easy task, and it's a year-round event. And basically, we're working with two budgets, the current budget that we're operating in the 23-24 school year, and building the 24-25 budget here at the same time. So, one thing that we need to know that's very important is that we, over the last 3 years, the South Huntington School District has added a lot of programs, a lot of items, to enhance our programs here in South Huntington. We received foundation aid from the state in increases of almost $12 to $13 million a year, which we are very appreciative of. But it's also money that was really owed to us to make us fully funded. So this year, we did receive from the executive budget, the governor's budget back in mid-January, did give us an increase of almost $4 million. Well, listen, we're not complaining about that. We will complain a little bit. I'll get to that in a second. But we also have districts out there, Three Village, that lost over $8 million. West Islip lost over $3 million. And when you get a health care bill from 1 year to the next that could equal almost, you know, a district of our size of almost $4 million, you can see how quickly and easily that money can be swallowed up as far as our increase goes. What I said I was going to complain in a second, this is what I'm going to complain about. We were owed, as promised by the governor, yes, we received almost a $4 million increase, but we're still owed about another $759,000 that we were expecting to receive. You know, the good news that I'm hearing regard to that. So I want to open up by saying, we really need to celebrate what South Huntington has brought on here in the last 3 years. And we're building a budget where we're trying not to let anybody go, and we're also looking to see where we can improve. Go on, give me such a slide. We thought we had the gate clear all like set before we got up here. What we do here, you have, one of the best nights of the school year, teacher of the year, that had taken place at our last board meeting over at Walt Whitman. It's a true joy to honor all the wonderful educators here. We're blessed to have such quality individuals. A game that I started, actually, the Maplewood ball, right, Bill?
That's right.
But you did a great job continuing it. And we were so happy to participate, and we're so happy that you keep it going. So these are just a couple of small things that we do here. There's a whole bunch of activities and wonderful things that we do here in South Huntington. So basically, tonight, we're not into the nitty-gritty yet of the budget. We still have work to do. We still have some numbers to attain, as far as what the tax levy will be. As far as our final number by the state, as far as our state aid goes. And, when you look at our rankings up here, as I tell everybody, I say to Kevin almost every time of the week, we still have room to grow. I know it's tightening a bit, but we absolutely do. And that's something that we spend each and every day working on. How can we be better as a school district? And we're working hard at it, and I think you see the results. And we want to keep moving in that same direction. So, we're in a good place, but anytime we can find, without hurting the program, and finding a financial efficiency, more or less a way that we can save money, we will do. And the last thing we ever want to do is to negatively impact any of our programs. And we've been pretty fortunate, over the last 3 or 4 years where we've just continued to add. And we're looking maybe to add a little bit going into next year. We have to still wait and see. But the great thing is, we're not having discussions here, as you may have read in online, news they reported that there was a school district losing 32 teachers. Okay, we're not having those kind of conversations. We're building on what we built here in South Huntington and what we will continue to build. So, Mr. Conway, let's get the budget going.
Thank you very much. I'm just going to work the keyboard for a few minutes while some of the other cabinet members run through their respective slides. So this first one I'll pass over to Dr. Steele.
Sure, thank you, Mr. Conway. As part of our work around diversity, equity, and inclusivity, we continue to monitor and ensure that our instructional programs offer a wide variety of culturally relevant voice resources, as well as have events and celebrations being inclusive for all. We have implemented STAR assessment in our elementary AAS program, and this resource gives us an additional data point to monitor and progress students in our AIS reading and math groups. We have expanded the research program for students in grades 6-8, and teachers work with students to introduce them to research topics and experiments. And we continue our work with instructional rounds, where teachers train to work with colleagues on identified problems in practice, and then visit classrooms throughout the district. Dr. Murphy will take the next slide.
Good evening, everyone. At the high school and secondary level, there's been a lot of work over the last 2 years. There's been a continued improvement on subject areas. We've added over 30 courses over the last 2 years that fit the needs of students, what their needs are vocationally, what their interests are, and this has had a profound impact on what they will be going into in their post-secondary degrees and what their wants are after they leave the hallways of Walt Whitman. A big focus of that has been on 21st century skills, especially with our engineering and computer science. A lot of these courses encompass that, which is something we see as a growing place where students will find jobs. But in addition to that, we've been also focusing on vocational programs at the secondary level. As I mentioned, computer science and engineering, but also brought back our automotive with small engines and basic automotive, where it's giving hands-on and tactile skills to students that find interest in those types of fields and gives them a solid base based on for what to expect if they want to keep furthering their education in those areas. We've also expanded on our internship program. This is with BOCES, where the students will go into the field of medicine, legal communications, healthcare, and they get a real-world application of what's going on through our BOCES contact, where they make connections with community members as well as businesses to give them those resources and those ability and that ability to get that experience. In addition to that, Dr. Folt is not able to be here today, so I just wanted to go through some of the technology additions that we've been able to do. Since COVID, we've been doing a lot of Chromebook replenishment and replacement, meaning every student from sixth grade on has a one-to-one Chromebook. We have Chromebooks throughout K through 12, but specifically at sixth grade, each individual student gets their own Chromebook. This is then replenished and recycled over the course of a couple of years. Basically, they get it in sixth grade, and then when they get to the high school in ninth grade, they get a new Chromebook to finish out through the rest of their high school career. In addition to that, we've added a new social media application called Move. It functions very much like social media, except it's geared towards students and utilizing information at the school level to be able to give students and parents up-to-date information on clubs, activities, lunch, transportation, anything that would encompass their school day. This is now at the high school. It's being rolled out to the middle school, and it will keep moving downwards so that students and parents can utilize this.
Dr. Murphy, in other words, this is going to be our district app.
Yes, it will be a district social media app. It functions, what we see is kids don't use Facebook. That's what they'll tell your grandma, that's what they use. It functions like Snapchat or other things. And that's why we utilize that so kids get become more engaged in learning about their school and some of the programs that go on.
This thing's pretty amazing. I mean, it's kind of a lot of stuff.
It's kind of cool, and it's actually amazing. The guy that owns it is only about 24 years old, came out of Notre Dame. He'll be a millionaire before he's 30, but he's just very good at it. And it's also because he employs some of our students through internships because they realize that he's not much older than them, what they can do, what they can accomplish at such an early age. So it is also a mentorship program for even us to utilize a program like this.
Okay, at some point in the future, we will be scheduling a presentation as we roll this out district-wide, this app. So we're very excited about what's to come.
In addition to that, we've been adding more increases to our usage of the campus, and we've been replacing a lot of our smart boards and interactive boards and computers to make sure that we're keeping up to date with 21st century technology and providing the tools necessary for our teachers and our students within the classroom. In addition, I have to talk about things that students and teachers use, but things like our firewall, switches, controls, access points. These are all our internal components of our technology system here at the high school and within the district, and these are being repeatedly checked and updated for our IT department. In addition to that, cybersecurity, we're consistently evaluating and documenting better ways to protect our students and staff and our district from cybersecurity attacks. And that's exclusively done through a lot of programs and applications utilized by our IT. That's our IT department that they're continuously monitoring and updating that. I'd like to now give it back over to Dr. Steele to talk about social emotional.
Thank you, Dr. Murphy. So social emotional well-being in our students remains a priority here for us in South Huntington. We continue to use Second Step as part of our SEL curriculum. That also includes push-in lessons, assemblies are facilitated by our district social worker. And all of this is guided by feedback that we get from the SEL survey from Panorama. And for the future, we're looking to expand all of these components in all grades 8 through 12. This is kind of a slide. And our mental health initiative, we have a partnership, as you know, this year with the mental health partnership. And through our work with them, we continue to explore and establish avenues for communication with the community. That will also in turn help support our families with access to resources. This also helps us support our mental health team with various referrals, for counseling, evaluations, and for school avoidance issues. And we also work with them on ways to enhance professional development opportunities for our staff. And that's it. Thank you, class, safety and
security. Thank you,
Dr. Thank you. Obviously, the most critical, most important thing before learning takes place in any school district and school building is making sure our students are safe and secure in their respective buildings. Probably the most important thing that you have in that capacity is oversight. I will mention specifically because he's here, Mr. Beck has been operating as our safety and security director for the district, and I can say honestly, there's not a day that does not go by, that does not stop in, visit my office, and we speak very specifically about things he's seeing around the district. He visits our buildings on a daily basis, confers with our principals, and also meets with our teachers. He really has been a wonderful spokesperson in making sure that our students are safe and making sure that he's advocating for any needs that the district might have. Most recently, we did add Cody cards to all our school buildings. What that gives us the ability to do, staff members will recognize this a little bit more. We operated on what we call the FOB system previously, which if you wanted access to a building, you actually had to print out a new disk that would go off the back of their IDs. Now we can control all that access directly from the Office of Human for Human Resources, or actually can end somebody's ability to get into a building or add them to an additional building just by a click of a button. The reason why that's a fantastic thing to be able to do, let's say you have a coach, for example, that's working up at Walton High School, but is a coach working in another building, you can simply add access for that sport for that period of time and have it end when that sporting season is over. It gives you a lot more control and ability to control who's coming in and out of our buildings. Most recently, we did add that aspect also to our transportation building. A few months ago, Dr. Rice and I actually went to all the buildings to do a RAVE app rollout with our staff members. But the RAVE app gives the staff members the ability on their fingertips, right on their phones, to be able to announce emergencies that are occurring in the buildings. As far as surveillance cameras throughout the district, we are continuing to upgrade our cameras throughout every school building. I always tell my own children that smile, you're on camera. Certainly everywhere we go today in society, you are certainly on camera. And that's something certainly here in South Huntington, we're making sure it's happening in our school buildings and any one of our buildings. Certainly gives us the ability to go look back and look at incidents, make sure that our buildings are as secure as possible. Our security vestibules, if you want to click to the next slide, I'll speak to them specifically. We added security vestibules to all of our school buildings. We are still waiting, construction starting in JKAO here as our last spot where we'll be a vestibule added to the district. But in the pictures you see in front of you, you see Oakwood Primary Center and Countrywood Primary Center. What this gives us the ability to do is truly vet anybody that is coming into our school building before letting them through our doors. There's a conversation that takes place before an individual is buzzed into the building. They are met between two double doors, and that's where that conversation continues to take place, where you're checking IDs and asking them why they're entering the building before that individual then is buzzing them to actually get through the threshold into our school buildings. It's a great way just to make sure that every individual that's coming to the building is properly vetted to make sure that they're in that building for a specific reason. There you'll see Birchwood and Maplewood Intermediate buildings as well, same setup. And next one, you'll see Siloswood and Stimson Middle School. These are larger projects in both these buildings. If you've been through those entryways, you know the larger doors to enter both Siloswood and Stimson Middle School. Communication upgrades. We worked hard during this school year to upgrade our PA systems in not only Stimson Middle School, but also in Walton High School. Also, we audited our walkie-talkies. That might sound like a strange thing to do, but once again, Mr. Beck went around to all the school buildings and made sure our walkie-talkies were able to speak to the outside as well, maintaining the same frequency. We did identify that some of our walkie-talkies were not able to do that. We did purchase replacements for Birchwood and also Stimson Middle School, and now all cabinet members at district office have the ability to be able to communicate with all of our school buildings in case of emergency. We do have a great partnership with law enforcement in collaboration with Second Precinct. We work very closely with our school resource officer, Officer Jinks, and providing support to our district. To start off this school year, Officer Jinks did attend meetings with myself and also Mr. Beck as part of our procedures to start off the school year. An evacuation plan is being reviewed. It was a great opportunity for us to be able to sit down and really collaborate and talk about what it would look like if our students were truly going to be exiting our buildings. We also, part of that, we did also travel over to St. Anthony's High School as well, take a look at that as one of our evacuation plans. Last year in the spring, we also hosted active shooter training that took place with Suffolk County PD and also Homeland Security at Walton High School. That is certainly something we're also interested in doing this spring as well at Stimson Middle School. I thought it would be good to get kind of security at a glance and what we do have here in South Huntington to make sure our buildings and students and staff are safe and secure. We do have our safety officers. That's one of the units that we probably most frequently, as a community member, you probably come in contact with. Those are the individuals that will be greeting you at the doorway. We're also maybe helping your child with their backpack out of their car as they arrive at some of our elementary buildings. Our security are individuals that are patrolling all of our 9 campuses throughout the district. They're doing this 24/7 and maintaining constant vigilance on our cameras as well. And then finally, the last layer of security is our armed security. They're maintaining outside perimeter of our buildings, and obviously one coming inside if there was a threat. On time, I'll keep it over to Mr. Conway to continue with the budget.
Thank you, Smith.
Okay, so just jumping on into the budget piece of this now. So this year we've recently transferred from the general fund into the capital fund, which is shy of $3.5 million, as was approved by the voters back in May of 2023. And you'll see up there a list of the projects that were part of last year's transfer to capital fund this year. And you can see if you couldn't pass the high school, these projects have been done on the outside, the features, the drainage system, soon to be the comfort station, the vestibule, Mr. Smith mentioned recently, as well as electronic message boards and some other projects that are currently underway. The budget process in general, what I'd like to equate to is nothing more than the way you look at your home personal finances. We all have to balance the situation. There's a certain amount of revenue coming in, and we have to anticipate and expect what expenses we kind of want to go out. So I would bring your attention on this fiscal overview for the current year we're living in, 23-24. I would bring your attention to that center number in yellow, the $204 million. That's our total revenue expected for this year, made up of three components, as you see, $123.6 million of taxation, just about $70.4 million state aid, and then approximately just shy of $10 million of other revenue. What that comprises of, what's that comprised of, rather, is things like we're billing other districts for health insurance we provide to the students that may attend private parochial school. It includes things like interest income or property rental income, employee share of health insurance that they contribute back towards the district. So that brings us to the total of 204. Jumping down to the bottom line, you'll see a total expense of around $209 million. You'll notice a rough gap of about $5 million. How do we fill that gap? It's those two lines in the middle, reserve usage and appropriated fund balance. What I would equate those two is one's personal savings. Reserve usage is, you could look at it in a way that it's one's personal savings earmarked for a purpose. You may save for vacation. That's what reserve is, it's putting money aside for a particular purpose. The appropriated fund balance would be already in day funded. So in this current year, we've allocated $1.9 million of reserves and $2.9 million of our fund balance to equate to a balanced budget for this current year. Just a visual representation up there. Taxation, as I just mentioned, represents around 59% of our revenue. State aid is 34. That other revenue is $5 million, and fund balance and reserves is roughly 2% of our revenue this year. If we break down this current year into a three-part budget, we see an administrative component of around $27 million, or 13%, and that includes things such as office salaries, administrative salaries, benefits, legal costs, insurance costs, auditing services, things of that nature. Programmatic expenses is around $154 million, or 74%, and that's really the sweet spot of where we want to see that percentage. That's what we're here for, that's the bread and butter of this business, if you will. And things that go into that number, teachers, building supervisors, salary, benefits, things like staff development, athletics, special ed costs, transportation, or guidance support. So everything directly correlated to the student and their day-to-day life is in that number there. And in the capital of around $27.7 million, also about 13%, represents things such as the transfer of capital or debt payments, borrowing interest, and various facilities, building grounds. State aid categories, we essentially on a high level have two. One is the foundation aid, the second one there is expense-based aid. So foundation aid has been around for quite some time, and the essence of it is for New York State to allocate proportionally their state money to the districts across the state. It's looking at things on a formula level, such as district wealth, student needs, enrollment, things like that. On any district state aid run, that is the single largest dollar amount in the state aid components. And this current budget development we're going through currently is, there are two proposals the governor has made. One is the elimination of the same harmless provision, and the second one she has proposed is a change to the inflation calculation in the formula. So what does that mean? In the same harmless provision, essentially New York State has guaranteed that school districts get the same amount of foundation aid in any given year as the prior year, regardless of a change to their respective formula. So for a particular district, saw, let's say, enrollment drop, which could have led to a drop in their foundation aid, this provision would have kicked in and held them flat with the prior year. It helps with their budgeting and just overall projections on the financial piece. And like I mentioned, she has currently proposed to eliminate this from the 24-25 school year. The second factor she is looking to change is that of the inflation factor. Within the state's state aid formula, there's a component referred to as inflation factor. Historically, it's looked at the prior year inflation, which on the current loan would be about 4.1%. What she's looking at doing currently, obviously the last few years inflation has been high, so in an effort for her to save money, she's looking to change it to a multi-year average of inflation, which would bring it from 4.1 in the current law down to 2.4. And what that does at the state level, this is Dr. DeLeo alluded to earlier, based on the November database, it is saving the state approximately $250 million across all districts. And to us, that's around $750,000, excuse me, that we are now currently hopeful to get back. We're cautiously optimistic. There are state and school agencies on both sides of the political aisle that are looking to push and advocate that this does not become law, and hopefully we get a piece of that restored back to us. On the expense-based aid, essentially what that is you're spending money in one year based on certain categories such as transportation, BOCES, building aid, in terms of final cost reports, and after that money is spent in year one, the following year, the state, when we submit our audit to the state, around October each year is when they factor those expenses and then give us a piece of that in the subsequent year in terms of expense-based aid. So a preview into what 24-25 school year has for us currently in terms of state aid. I'll run through those three numbers with you now. The foundation aid is approximately $54.8 million. Foundation aid alone is around $2.9 million above last year's, around 5.7%. The expense-based aid, which I just went through, is around $20.8 million, an increase of around $811,000, just over 4%. And we have universal pre-kindergarten aid of $1,794,000 for a total package of $77.5. The caveat I have to mention is that the universal pre-kindergarten, that's actually accounted for in our federal fund. It's outside of our general operating fund that the voters vote on in May each year. So in terms of our operating day-to-day budget, it's those top two numbers, the foundation aid and the expense-based aid. Those numbers have increased at this time of $3.7 million, or roughly 5.24%. And again, we'll remain cautiously optimistic as this process unfolds. Some of the high-level costs, or high-level some of the costs we're facing is on a pension system level. We have an employee retirement system, which is essentially our non-certificated folks. We're looking at an increase of 2.1% with that. And then the teacher's retirement system, it's the teachers and building principals, various administrators. That's looking at a slight increase of 0.26%, but obviously as those are both tied to salaries, we're expecting dollar amount increases there. Then with a big number here is healthcare costs. This is no surprise that year after year recently, it's been quite significant changes. And just to look, if we were to take, for example, a family plan package from January 24 compared to where we were January 20. Those two numbers in isolation is a 40% increase, those 4 year gap. Mm-hmm. If we take an average of the last 3 years individual increases, we're looking at approximately 11% increase. And in this current January, we've received a look around 8 or 9%. So what that means in terms of budgeting is the healthcare is run on a calendar year, January to December, we're facing the July to June budget. So going into next year, we know what our July through December healthcare costs should be. Come January 25 is where we have introduced that variable of using our best judgment and history of speaking with people that can kind of come up with the best estimate we can for the back half of the year. Some goals for the district for the upcoming school year. Obviously, this place does not want to sit still. We are always looking to push the boundaries and strive for excellence. We would like to obviously continue to provide opportunities that meet students in terms of academic as well as social, emotional, and mental needs to become a better, well-rounded person. That goes hand in hand with identifying and closing achievement gaps and always looking to observe, identify, and possibly expand programs where appropriate. We would like to always identifying strengths in various community partnerships which may be available, such as we spoke to earlier with the Northwell Health Partnership to help families. All of these things are critical to offer students everything they need, and we also must be mindful of the financial component of that. So doing this with a fiscal sustainability goal in mind, and as Mr. Smith mentioned, keeping the safety of our faculty and our staff and our students, number one, is important, as well as the facilities and grounds. We want this place, this campus, to look beautiful, to feel nice when the students walk in, to have a nice learning experience throughout their day and after school activities. And my last slide is just simply an upcoming list of budget meetings, culminating with the budget vote and referendum on May 21st of this year. Are there any questions?
Thank you, Mr. Dominic, for your job.
Thank you.
Okay, we'll move into our business agenda, and of course, the following meetings will continue to develop. So we'll get a little more specifics on the programs and expenses as we go along and fill in our projected budget increase, our tax levy, and our tax rate increase. All right. On to our business agenda. First, I'll take a motion to amend the agenda so as to add personnel schedule 3 to item K. Is there a motion to amend the agenda? Mr. Harris, seconded by Mr. Ross. All in favor of amending the agenda? Any opposed? All right, and then I'll take a motion to approve the agenda as amended. Motion. Mr. Scraggs, seconded by Mr. Rigasa. All in favor? Any opposed? All right, items E through H require one resolution for adoption. We have minutes, financial items, no bids, and bills. Motion. Mr. Joyner, seconded by Ms. Meyer. Any questions on items E through H? All in favor? Any opposed? All right, we'll move on to new business. New business item number one is not a voting item, but it's a discussion of e-books for our budget and board elections on the 21st rather than our paper books. And I'll turn it over to Ms. Caliendo, who has researched this and frankly is recommending it.
Thank you, Mr. Santana. Over the past few years, more and more districts have moved away from the paper books that you traditionally see. You go in, they're listed alphabetically. Our district has 14 books. With 14 workers, additional workers to cover them when they need to take a break. In the first year that I was here, certainly not something that I really looked into because I wanted to keep everything the same. But when I speak to more and more of my colleagues and learn about the system, learn about it through workshops, it is definitely more efficient and has a lot to offer. My current proposed system was kind enough to come here tonight to help share a little bit more information, so I'd like
to
come up.
Thank you. Welcome, everyone. And thank you. You saved some money. What we were just talking about.
If you like.
Oh, okay, great.
And Ms. Gallagher, while he's setting up, we're talking about the books that like the voters sign in on with their signature. Is that what we're replaced?
Yes, that's exactly what we're replaced. So when you come in and anyone in the district come in or other districts, you come in, you vote, there's a large binder that has, you know, A, B, C, D. These books would eliminate, the paper would eliminate the lookup, the time that it takes to look up the name, potentially avoid a resident signing on the wrong line, which does happen. And these books, you don't need to, nothing is, you don't need an alphabetical breakout. You can go to anyone who could have 5 books, 7 books.
Correct, and that's one of the biggest benefits. Instead of having the books like you're familiar with, alphabetized, where you have 14 currently, using the e-books, as we call them, and it's very similar, I'll say, to the Board of Elections, what they've been using the last couple of years. You don't have to, again, what we always heard computer, you know, it's not paper, but people have gravitated to this. If you go out there and post these listserv, you can just ask about it. We really don't promote it, it's really the districts are promoting it. We have, I think on Long Island, probably close to, we have probably about 70 districts in all, probably a little bit more than that, and I would say by next year, everybody will be on these. They're just, everyone just, again, the efficiency. I had a district that had 3,500 people come out unexpectedly, and they only had three of these, and they were able to do over 100 an hour to move people through. And they felt that there was no way by paper that they would be able to do that so quickly. And it really, again, keeps people moving. Understand, everyone's busy. You know, one of the hesitations is, I don't want to wait. And where these, again, move you right along. You don't have to wait in line. If your last name starts with an A, you can go over here. The most has to be done is to direct people that they don't have to wait in the line. You know, so everyone thinks, okay, I'm with a spouse or what have you, and they're waiting in the line behind them, but again, you can go over. So it's just worked out tremendously for us.
Is this an app that you supply, or do you supply the?
We supply the machine and everything. So we supply all the equipment. What we're testing now is, everyone knows what a stylus is, obviously, but we're testing the Microsoft stylus, which looks very close to the signature. So we've been testing with some districts from special elections, and they really love it. So we're rolling those out.
Do you take the books back after the election?
Correct.
And what about like the data itself? Do we own the data, so would we run a report, you know, from the district reports on it?
As far as reports, we have a robust reporting. You can get reports every hour during the election. You can, at the end, obviously, you're basically building your poll books. So where in the past, you may have somebody writing that down, and someone comes in, this year automatically starts to build it for you. So you could run one at any time during the day.
So for example, this year we changed our voting hours to 2 to 9, from 3 to 10. And when we were looking at it, we were interested to know like how many people voted in the 9 to 10 hour, but we weren't able to capture that. So can this do something like
absolutely.
That?
Absolutely. And that has also helped a lot of districts, whether they were looking to reduce, or some districts were looking to maybe expand, depending on the volumes they were getting on the one. I have one district that they go out for lunch. They have a break between lunch. It's only one, but it's something that I've never seen before. So they stop at 11, they come back at 1. But yes, as far as the reporting is concerned, it breaks down, I'll say, not only the folks that come in, but your absentees and your early voters now that has gone into effect.
How would you keep track of the absentees? Because they wouldn't sign this, right? Or?
No, they don't sign this, but you can, at the end of the evening, depending on what your process is, there's a section in here where you can mark the absentee. So as you're going through them, you can just look up the person and mark that person absentee. Again, depending what your process is, some people may do it first. And what happens is, I know it's probably very difficult to see this. And as you can see too, on this where if someone has come in, it'll shade out where you can't select that person. That person's already voted. So there's some, I'll say some functionality in here where, again, if someone voted or voted by absentee, depending on what your process is, it'll be marked that person voted absentee or early mail. we work with the Board of Elections. We take the Board of Elections list and we purge the data that needs to be purged, people that drop off, the people that are on, change in addresses. That's all done by the system. If you have in-district voters, people that may have registered prior, those would be included in that as well. So at the end of the day, once the election is complete, we send you what we call archive the election, and basically it looks just like your books, basically. So you have a PDF of that for your records.
Questions from the board?
I said, first of all, I like the idea. It seems there's a lot of bees, so I'm like, I am okay to go online. But as far as PDF, do you also keep a backup, like either on your servers or a cloud, in case there's a challenge on the road, or is the district responsible for getting that PDF as a record of as far as the record?
Well, yeah, in our systems are hosted by BOCES too, so you have BOCES, Eastern South Dakota BOCES hosts the data. So they have that data in this back. Then again, you will get an archive, and again, we can recreate if we have to.
Ms. Gallagher, I know we do same day registration, right? Mm-hmm. How would this work with that? Any impact or?
No,
currently what you use is our registration form that is completed.
Okay.
And that is either entered in that day or next day into the system.
Okay. So that person doesn't sign in this time?
No.
Okay.
That is something we're working on to have you be able to do that.
Okay.
So that's something that we are looking at for the future, is if someone does come in once everything's been verified and fit into that person's statements. But they sign it for that.
I just want to ask, what is the training like?
The training is so easy. It's about 15 minutes. And many of the workers that do work are from the Board of Elections. So they're very familiar with working on computers now, which is great. And this is a little bit easier than the Board of Elections. They have a few other functions that they need to do. I would say no more than 15 minutes. We do the training. We will come and train the workers. What we've seen, though, is that the district clerk can do that. But we offer it. We do it. There's no additional cost. On the day of the election, some will be around. We're always around throughout the state. So we're always there walking and checking on how things are going. We monitor each machine back at the office, make sure it's communicating, and if it's not, we send an email, phone call, so they let you know that maybe one of them, the internet is down. And the other function, too, when you mentioned the internet, we do have a fail-safe built in. The internet is needed so they communicate to one another. If your internet is out for a period of time, it was a few years back, there was a supercell that came through and knocked out Upper Westchester and Rockland County. They were out for several hours. The machine can patch all that information until your internet's back up. And with these two is you can change it to a book if you had to. So if there's no communication, you can go in, there's options we built in where you can change this book now to A to K. And then all your A-to-K's would go to this. So we've been partnering with districts for over 30 plus years. And you know, we're always customizing, you know, for the district's needs. One of the big things is too is right now you have 14 books. You could probably cut that in half easily. Very easy to cut. Again, I think Professor Wells from 1200 that had come out. That's very little for a book, you know, for the time you definitely cut down to at least 7. And even a lot of people don't want to cut down too much the first year, they want to kind of see, so they usually will cut it in half, and then next year we'll see how it works. And you can always increase too if you need it. But we've seen it where sometimes there's certain special folks where you may only need 3 books, or you need 8 books. So
to new business item number two, approval of the single audit report. Thank you, sir. As prepared by R.S. Abrams for year ending June 2023, Mr. Conway. Oh, excuse me. Sorry, motion. Johnson, seconded by Mr. Viacosta. Mr. Conway.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Tonight for approval is the annual single audit report for the June 23 year end. This is required for all U.S. entities receiving over $750,000 or more in federal grant money. Last year, we received just over $11 million. The two areas which R.S. Abrams focused on this year was the child nutrition program, just over $2.4 million, and the ARP and COVID grants around $5.2 that year. This was discussed in great detail in our audit committee meeting on January 30th and presented by Audit Department Brendan Nelson. I'm happy to report that it was a clean, unmodified opinion, and very much corrective actions to be taken. And we continue to have a great partnership with R.S. Abrams.
Thank you, Mr. Conway. Mr. Bronson, thank you.
I was just going to add that one question that I asked was how other districts have been, because since this was a very active year for federal funding with COVID. And so while we were pleased that our district got in bullet health, that wasn't an easy answer. Not every district did. So I just want to, again, thank the team in South Huntington and again, especially for my team to have us come out of the clean office.
Great. Any other questions? All in favor? Any opposed? All right, moving on to item number three, approval of the calendar for the 2024-2025 school year. Motion, advised, seconded by Mr. Smith, eagerly awaited.
This is a very exciting moment for a lot of people. So, thank you, Mr. Smith, see you about it. For the board's approval is the 24-25 proposed school calendar. It does speak to 182 days and two conference days. Most importantly, what everybody's wondering, staff members are going to come back to us August 26, 2024 in this calendar, and our students will return to us Wednesday, August 28.
Okay. I was hoping Andrew has some information.
That's right.
And we're just talking about holidays in the calendar?
Yeah, absolutely. So highlights, this does come for a two-week holiday break in December. Obviously this school year, Chinese New Year fell on a weekend. We will be observed next year in late January, so that is added to the calendar. Also, the board approved Diwali, which is something we'll be recognizing as a holiday in early November as well.
So the students will have the day off after Halloween.
That is it. So the day after Halloween, students will be off. Staff, you know, just a whole set of
Board of any questions?
I was going to add, and just correct me if I'm wrong, Smith. Also, the Wednesday before Thanksgiving is also a holiday, which was
the So the Wednesday before Thanksgiving, we will be off that day as well. So it's coming back earlier, but with that, based upon the discussion with the committee, we have a lot of things getting ready to start out.
And the Monday after Easter. Everybody should be happy. Everybody happy, I think. Dr. Galea?
Yeah, just one more thing also about the two-week break. As far as I know, as of this moment, 14 of the 18 Western Suffolk Posey districts will be operating 2 weeks during that time. So the majority are following exactly which way we're heading to.
Okay. Yeah. Questions? All in favor? Any opposed? Thank you, Mr. Smith, and to the calendar committee. Move on to a series of policies that we're adopting. We have two new board policies and two revised policies. We'll start with the revised policies. And the first one up is revised board policy 5515, which speaks to capital assets. Is there a motion? Mr. Strang, seconded by Ms. LaCara. Mr. Conway?
Thank you, Mr. Cicero. So the next approval is a revised capital asset policy. The revisions were minor in detail, but primarily related to incorporating IT and related technology into the new policy. It has been reviewed with all appropriate stakeholders and is before you for approval. The limits for non-IT items remains $1,500, and for IT items is $1,000. This was previously unspecified, as the policy was changing out. And on a side note, walkable items that can be walkable are maintained for tracking purposes.
Questions on the policy? All in favor? Any opposed? All right, we're going to move on to item five, which is a revision to board policy 7515, our wellness policy. Is there a motion? Mr. Bronson, seconded by Mr. Biancasa. Ms. Meyer, can you update us on this?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Scampetta. So this is a revision of the wellness policy, and the wellness committee has been working over the last year to revise the policy.
9520.6, which is the right of employees to express breast milk. Is there a motion for that? Mr. Dornish and Mr. Meyer, and to tell us about that policy, Mr. Bronson.
Sure, I'd be happy to. This is a new policy. New York State requires policy regarding this expression of breast milk. Policy is very detailed. It covers a number of topics, including appropriate unpaid breaks, which would be in addition to any required meal or rest breaks. It also covers the type of facility or space that must be utilized or provided for extraction of breast milk, such as a natural or well lighted artificial space, electricity for a pump, etc. And also covers the process for requesting the ability to have those breaks by a returning employee. Every new hire, as well as employees, are just provided a copy of this policy, which is also going to be posted. And so we ask that the board adopts policy. It's going to be appropriate constituents for review and comments.
Thank you, Mr. Bronson. With respect to the lactation room requirements, we were actually ahead of the curve on this. Facilities committee worked on this last year. We had all these built out during last year. Thank you for reviewing that policy. Any questions on the policy? Anything to add? All in favor? Any opposed? All right. And moving on to new business, new board policy 5605, voter registration and pre-registration. Motion? Ms. Bronson, second by Ms. LeCara. Ms. Bronson?
I'm sure this is our voter pre-registration. The district believes in the importance of the ability for individuals to vote, and so what the district has proposed here with this policy is that individuals that are not 18 years of age yet can actually have the opportunity to pre-register when they're 16 years of age. So again, there's no pressure, it's voluntary, there's no consequence if they don't want to register to vote. Certainly there's no influence on how they vote, but really it's a pre-registration policy so that they can register once they're 16, and then automatically the eligibility is re-verified when they're 18, and then they'd be registered to vote. It just gives us, it's an opportunity for individuals that are still in the schools to register to vote in the future.
Thank you, Mr. Bronson. We've been also working on this for many years. We have a program, at least a decade, voter registration practice over in the high schools. Good to know. Thank you. Questions? All in favor? Any opposed? All right, we're moving on to item eight, some obsolete equipment. Is there a motion? Ms. Pregoss, seconded by Mr. Craig. And for the first time, Ms. Cavanaugh, welcome.
Thank you. With the board's approval, we have a list of items to be declared obsolete. There's a list of Chromebooks where the operating system is no longer supported.
Okay. Questions? All in favor?
Sure, so Mr. Pingasso
and I have basically done the search for a new community member with the unfortunate passing of Jim Caden. The position was posted. We had an interview ultimately with the county that we're asking for to approve. She has a significant background in working with a number of financial institutions. I think she'll be very good. Just like Mr. Caden, I think she is not going to just sort of sit back. I think she sees something, she said something based on this is one of the stories that she told us during the interview. And so we would actually welcome her to be our other community member along with Ruth Ann Cooley, who's been a community member for a number of years. So again, I'd ask that that the board vote in this Scarborough to be our new community member on the audit committee.
Thank you, Mr. Bronson. Thank you, Mr. Bingasson, for conducting the meeting too. Any questions? All in favor? Any opposed? Welcome, Ms. Scritchover, to the audit committee. All right, we now have a series of travel and conferences. So the first one is for attendance by board, Pavilion board members at the Winter Institute Lobby Day in Albany, taking place in early March. Is there a motion? Mr. Bronson, second by Mr. Strahan. Any questions? All in favor? Any opposed? All right, moving on to item number 16 is the approval for four board members, Dr. D'Elia and Dr. Steele, to attend the Tri-CYA Hall of Honor on March 21st at Lark Field Manor. One of the honorees there will be a South Bend employee and a nighttime security guard, Mike Pastore. Is there a motion? Mr. Bronson, second by Mr. Strahan. Any questions? All in favor? Any opposed? Moving on to item 17, approval for a board member to attend the National School Board Association annual conference in early April. Motion. Mr. Pingasso, seconded by Mr. Bronson. Any questions? All in favor? Any opposed? All right, moving on to item number 18 is the approval of a grant from Stop and Shop. Motion. Ms. Meyer, seconded by Mr. Joyner. Dr. D'Elia.
Yes, very, very good news. Back in 2022, Christina Lanier, a former Wolverton High School student, started a food pantry at Wolverton High School, and we're happy to announce that Stop and Shop is looking to give us another $10,000 grant from Giving Hearts. This is about, in total, $30,000 over the last few years, so they've been an unbelievable support too, because we're supporting about 50 families within our community. So my recommendation to the board. We'd be very happy to accept this.
Okay. All in favor of the recommendation? Any opposed? Very nice. Send the letter to Stop and Shop. Thank you. Okay, moving on to item number 19. We can now begin a series of overnight field trip requests. Is there a motion for the first one, which is the annual Decker Conference motion? Mr. Strahan, seconded by Mr. Giannassi. Ms. Kavanaugh.
So we have seven students and one chaperone headed to Rochester for the annual DECA conference. I'm told that if they do well, they could progress to nationals and national.
Okay, going in early March, I heard the weather is beautiful in Rochester. It's
not much better at all.
No. That's true. Any questions? All in favor? Any opposed? All right. Moving on to number item 20 is a trip off Long Island to MetLife Stadium. This is exciting. Motion. Mr. Bronson, seconded by Mr. Strahan. Ms. Kavanaugh again.
We have two students and one chaperone headed to, as you said, MetLife Stadium. Apparently, since this began, the Jets have been a sponsor. Our students will attend to collaborate on how to make the program even better.
Right. Play football, which is growing in popularity. Any questions? All in favor? Any opposed? Moving on to new business 21, approval of an overnight field trip request for the Puerto Rican Hispanic Youth Leadership in Albany. So, I'm going on Albany. Motion. Mr. Bronson, seconded by Mr. Strahan. Ms. Kavanaugh.
We have three the Winter Percussions Competition. This is in March and April, multiple dates, and our students will be participating.
Great. Questions? All in favor? Any opposed? All right. And moving on to item number three, this is an exciting one. Is there a motion? Ms. Meyer, seconded by Mr. Scragg. Ms. Cavanaugh, I'll let you give the surprise here. You're on the roll.
A phenomenal opportunity for our students next year in 2025 in January to head to Disney World in Florida to have our marching band, jazz band, and wind ensemble march through Disney World.
A little nice at all, thanks.
Yeah. Yeah. A little warmer.
That's awesome.
About 65 to 100 students, depending on the enrollment.
That's wonderful. That's great.
You
can go.
For 10 to 20 chaperones, depending on the
cost. Any questions? All in favor? Any opposed? All right. Moving on to item number four, approval of license agreement for the Huntington Unity Day. Motion. Mr. Brunson, second by Mr. Green, that's Mr. Scragg. Dr. D'Elia.
Yes, happy to say that we have a date of April 6th for our Unity Day. We work in close partnership with the town of Huntington and specifically Ron Taylor Hood, who's been a big friend of the district. And we are ready to go. And we had a meeting last week, actually. So we didn't have the event in September due to weather. And we're praying for Mother Nature that that's Saturday, April 6th, sunshine. So we're looking forward to the event and we'll be ready to go.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Lee, for your work on this. And you know, we know that Dean Thompson, who was so influential on this, passed away. So it's great to continue the spirit of Unity Day. Any questions? All in favor? Any opposed? All right, moving on to item 25, approval of the data security and confidentiality agreement. Is there a motion? Mr. Scragg, seconded by Mr. Bronson. Dr. Steele.
Yes.
Don't want to leave you out.
We have a data and privacy agreement with Tinkercad, which is an app for use in 3D design and coding. It helps to build STEM confidence through project-based learning and is appropriate for all of us.
Any questions about this field? All in favor? Any opposed? All right, moving along. Confidential personnel resolution discussed in executive session for a 9/13. Pursuant to education law, 9/13. Motion. Mr. Gosser, second by Mr. Scragg, as Mr. previously discussed in the exact session. So we'll move to a vote. All in favor? Any opposed? And we reach the end of our new business with item 27, recommendations for the placements of students by the Committee on Special Education, dates listed in December, January, February, and preschool special education, dates listed November, December. Is there a motion? Ms. Meyer, second. Mr. Scragg. Any questions? All in favor? Any opposed? All right. That's a lot of new business. Moving on to personnel. Personnel schedules 2, 3, 5, 7, 9, 10, 11, 13, 15, 16, 17, 19, 20, and 22. Is there a motion? Mr. Scragg, second. Ms. Cross. Any questions? All in favor? Any opposed? All right. Information reports are listed. Order report. Ron, do you have any updates for
I'll just keep it brief. The only thing I would add compared to the condition of the single audit report is that we are currently in our purchasing cycle review, and we expect the draft of that report to be available to us in March.
Great. Facilities Committee, I'll give a quick update given the hour. The bleachers, as you can see, are demolished, and we're continuing to work on them. We believe that it's on schedule. Our fitness center is also on schedule. The new floor has been installed. The room has been painted. Walls have been taken down. Turf has been added. This is going to be a turf section. The lighting has been updated, as well as the electric. And that does, we expect the fitness equipment to arrive in February, so that is up to date. We continue to discuss our capital projects for the upcoming school year. We have some significant expenses, particularly with boilers that need to be replaced at a few buildings. And so we recommend making some recommendations to the Board of Education on those. Our EPC work continues. We're still working to get the solar arrays on grid, which we expect to happen relatively soon. And as we said, that construction should begin relatively shortly.
to kind of highlight my experience down in Washington, D.C. for the National School Boards Association Advocacy Week, which included New York State School Boards Association as well. So through the leadership of Bob Vecchio and Lorraine and Susan Bergman down here as well, we had a great time, able to really get around. I'm very busy. We had a tight window to work with. They did have programming on Monday. It was a three-day event. So they had programming that assisted and had presenters speak as well. Regards to our focus, I was able, thanks to Regina and also to Michael, to lead a personalized package for each elected official on the federal level, introducing them to Huntington, South Huntington, and also making sure that they had an invite to come down and visit. Of course, some of the major issues that we talked about was Title I and IDA funding. It was a discussion about assault deduction as well, also universal school meals and staffing shortages. So it was really a great time to talk about how federal legislation has made a difference in our achievements here in the school district, and also specifically talk to programs, American Rescue Act and other funding streams like that, and what it's done for our district and kind of highlight the impact of it on our district. So it was a great time, covered a lot of ground in a short amount of time.
Great, thank you for recommending the district. So the pitches look great, and I spoke to Mr. Vecchio afterwards, and he said you did a great job recommending, representing South Huntington, so thank you.
What a job.
Any other comments? Dr. Billia?
No.
Oh, sorry, Ms. Meyer.
Thank you. Just quickly, I just want to continue to recognize all the great work and community effort that's been going on across the district. Thank you especially to our PTAs and PTA Council for another very successful PARP week at the elementary levels last week. It's always great to see, you know, every year you find a different theme and a different way to get kids really re-engaged in reading, and that's wonderful to see. And then just also want to call out Silas Wood that did their annual polar plunge with the Long Beach polar bears, I guess they are, this past weekend, and they've been doing it for several years, raising money for the Make-A-Wish Foundation, and this year was extra special because one of the Silas students is actually a Make-A-Wish child that's getting his wish granted. So it's very heartwarming to see. It was covered by News 12 as well as Newsday. Really highlighting the efforts and what a community South Huntington is and always is to really rally around this all. And good luck to everyone and have a healthy and safe winter break.
Thank you, Mark. Dr. Villian.
Yes, real quickly, on March 1st, the portal will open up for Wildcat Sports Camp, Bacon and Cody. That's two different camps. So. Bacon, Cooking, and Cody. Set. At Arlington Theater, absolutely. Something that we introduced last year that we, because of its success, we will continue this year. So I know certain portions of the camp actually book pretty quickly. So we will send out a parent square a couple days prior to March 1st. I think we already sent one out as well, letting them know. But we'll send out something probably 2 days before, on Friday. And good luck. So I know it's a well run. All the camps are extremely well run, and it's a good deal that they get, and they get a big bang for their buck, no matter which part of the camp they attend. So, because I know there's students from other districts that take advantage of this when there's openings. You know, obviously South Huntington is priority, but if there's openings, you know, other people do jump in. They realize what we have here, because it's not available in many districts, what we have. So, you can be very clear about that. So, March 1st, be on the lookout. And everybody have a great winter recess. Can't believe it's moving along. The week we come back, that Friday is March 1st. Can't believe it.
Good call, Dr. Villia, on the snow day. Very,
my pleasure.
Great decision. And our hill got a lot of use. We saw a lot of kids over there. So
it's a great. Staple of our district.
I want to wish good luck to the girls' varsity basketball team. They'll be entering the playoffs. It was an unbelievably exciting game that they played this week against William Floyd. Did lose, but it was really well attended. And boys basketball also had a good year. We've got a lot of other great things going on. We sent a lot of wrestlers to the county championships. Girls did very
Valentine's Day, is really an opportunity to reflect not just on love and affection, but also on the love we have for our community and the commitment we share towards education. First and foremost, let us express our appreciation for all those educators, administrators, and staff who pour their hearts into providing quality education to our students every single day. Your dedication and passion are the foundation of our school system, and we are truly grateful for your tireless efforts. On this day of love, let us also remember the love we have for our students. Each one is unique with their own talents, dreams, and potential. As a board, it is our responsibility to ensure that every student feels supported, valued, and empowered to succeed. Let us remind ourselves. Sorry, I just lost my shirt. Let us recommit ourselves to creating an inclusive and nurturing learning environment where every student can thrive. In the spirit of Valentine's Day, let us also extend our gratitude to the families and caregivers who entrust us with the education and well-being of their children. Your partnership is invaluable, and together we can achieve great things for our students. Happy Valentine's Day, everybody, and may the love and warmth of this day inspire us to continue striving for excellence in education. Thank you.
Thank you, Jack.
Thank you, Valentine. I just want to quickly give my report as I go over to the high school. We're certainly moving along. We have multiple winter sports and bring into, as Mr. Sieff had said, into our counties, bowling, track, wrestling, and we have our cheer that made its nationals, which I think is a great achievement. So congratulations to all those winter sports teams. We have the spring musical, which I'm excited to announce is Mamma Mia. The dates are April 12th and 13th.
And you're in it?
I'm in it. So yeah, it's my swan song, as they said. So everybody come out to support Center Stage Productions. And finally today, I think we had something really special. As we're very fortunate, we have our neighbors right across the street at Sunrise Senior Living Facility. So our ninth graders today were able to go over there for Valentine's Day and gave them little gifts, and they got to speak with them and play games and really seeing the smile on the resident's face is just, I mean, it's unmatched. And even, and certain students are even able to be taken up to the memory care unit. And even though a lot of those patients have lost their memory, they're still able to thank our students for what they've done, and they just enjoy it so much, and it's really so great to see. So we're in pretty good shape. I look forward to meeting with the middle schools, sixth grade center, and intermediate schools, my monthly check-ins, and hope everybody has a good night and great winter recess. Thank you.
Thank you. Voice of the resident. All right. No.
Just say hi.
We will take a motion not to adjourn, but to go into executive session to discuss the matter of personnel. This is my second by Mr. Green Gospel. All in favor? Any opposed? Be well, everyone. Happy Valentine's Day.